Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Dave Learned. I'm one of the pastors on our Rolling Meadows campus. And I just want to tell you, I'm so glad you're with us for worship today. And of course, happy 4th of July weekend. What an opportunity we have to worship together today. Hey, as we get started, can I just invite you to check in? Maybe it's your first time here with us. Welcome. We're so glad you're with us for worship. Maybe you're doing this every weekend, and welcome back. It's really a great honor to worship together. And in this current reality, we might have people all over the world worshiping together. We don't know. But the main thing is our attention is on the Lord Jesus Christ. We'd love to know you're here, and we'd love to be able to care for you today. Hey, can I make a little observation, maybe a testimony? I have found that as each week of this online worship experience has been happening, there's a temptation I'm fighting. And it's this, to be more and more casual in the way I engage with worship. Sometimes I find I'm sitting more in the reclined position than the up position. Sometimes I find I'm not ready to sing and give my full attention to the Lord, or I'm distracted by my phone or my coffee. Whatever it is for you, can I just challenge you and encourage you? We're about to worship the Lord Jesus Christ together. He's worthy. He's worthy of our very best investment, our best attention, the best we could give Him. So I want to encourage you to lean in and give Him the best you can give Him today, all right? And I want to pray before we worship. So let's pray together right now. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this opportunity. We do not want to take it for granted. And we do want You to know that we love You, that we worship You, that we serve You, that we need to hear from You today. So Lord, would You help us in this moment to interact with You, to worship You with our best? We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Glory come down. Don't hold back. mistakes. Your death became the death of shame. I'll praise you for amazing grace. Up from the grave, into the dark, you call.
My weakness, God, I know you are strong. Help us rest. Help us rest in who you are, God. Yeah. Lord God, we do stand in awe of who you are. God, we're so grateful for how you care for us. We're so grateful for your love toward us, Lord. Thank you, God, that no matter what we face today, no matter what tomorrow looks like, we know that you're in control of it all, that nothing just slips through your hands, oh God. But you are the King, you are the ruler who watches over his word to perform it. This is who you are, God. God, I pray that we would really believe it today, God, that the one that we're worshiping is the God who is over all things and in control over all things. You're over all that I know, and I can trust you. We can trust you. We can trust you. We receive that today, that truth, God, that you are trustworthy, that you are good, that you're working things out for our good. We love you so much, Jesus. We pray all these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus. Amen. Yes and amen.
Hey, as we continue in worship today, I've got a couple of things I want to make sure you're aware of. The first one is this, student camps at Camp Harvest. Now, I got to tell you, this is a highlight of the summer, and we're so excited for the opportunity to offer student camps. We have a session coming up, three of them actually. One is for junior high students from all of our campuses. That's happening July 14 to the 18th. And then there's going to be two opportunities for high school students. The first one is for our Elgin and Crystal Lake students. That's July 19 to 23. And then another camp week for high school students, July 25th to 29th. That's for all of our students from Rolling Meadows in Chicago, at the Cathedral campus, our Aurora campus, and Deerfield Road. Now, can I just tell you, as a dad, I've got three girls in those age brackets. They are going, and it is always one of the best weeks of the summer for them. If you've got a student who wants to go, we'd love to talk to you about it. We'd love to answer your questions. They're doing a great job of getting that all ready for the summer, and you can sign up even today at harvestnow.info. Hey, here's the second thing. This summer, we're doing something together as a church family. We're calling it the Mind, Body, and Soul. And we've got a July challenge for you. So we did some stuff in June. That's in the past. Now we're moving ahead with some personal challenges for each of us, for our minds, for our bodies, and for our souls. You ready? Here they are. For our mind, for July, we're going to read this book. It's called Reconciliation Blues. So get a book. Get your hands on that, however you get books, and we're going to read that together. Now, for our bodies, ready? You ready for a challenge? Here it is. Sleeping 8 hours a night. That sounds awesome. I think I'm going to do that one. And also, drinking 8 glasses of water. Now, I think, is that for the month or? It's probably for the day, I think. 8 glasses a day. 8 hours of sleep, 8 glasses of water, and then this. Exercise 3 times a week, just 30 minutes, just to take care of the body the Lord's entrusted to us. So that's mind and body, and here's the thing for our soul. The challenge for July is this, to practice a 24-hour Sabbath rest once a week for the month of July. Maybe you're already doing this great, but most people I know, self-included, we need to grow in this to have time to focus on the Lord. So I hope you're challenged by that. I want to do this together. I want to hear how it goes for you. And you can get all the info again at harvestnow.info. Something everybody's interested in is a return to church timeline. Man, I'm so glad we're talking about this because I can't wait to see you all face to face. The good news is, Lord willing, it's coming. And beginning the weekend of August 15th and 16th, we're going to get to return to church in person. Now, of course, there's going to be some guidelines that go with that. There's going to be some limited capacity to how many can come. But I want you to know that all the details are coming from your campus, and you'll be able to indicate what service you want to come to. We'll plan it accordingly. It's going to be wonderful to get back together. I cannot wait to see you and to worship the Lord together. As we do that, we're going to do that in the safest, wisest, most loving way to care for everybody in the process. So, you know, we also recognize some won't be able to return to church for a variety of reasons right away. We want you to know we're going to continue our online services. So just like we've had them, Saturday at 5, Sunday at 9, 11, you'll still be able to join us in worship online. All the details are on the website, the return to church timeline, coronavirus updates. Can you guess where? HarvestNow.info. That's such a great place to go. All right, last thing. We've worshiped through song. In a moment, we're going to worship the Lord through His Word. And we just want to tell you, we're so thankful that God is faithful to our church through the giving, through the tithes and offerings of all of us together. It's been a hard season for so many, and yet the Lord is faithful. But I just want to remind you simply, there's four ways you can give if you want to worship through giving. Our website, you can find that there. The Harvest Bible Chapel app is a great option. There's a text number. Look here, you can do that. And then through mail. If you want to send snail mail, send it to our Rolling Meadows campus. All of that to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray before we get into His Word together today. Heavenly Father, I thank You for a weekend that reminds us that we live in a country where we have freedom. And Lord, that is a great privilege that we can't take lightly. Thank You that we can worship Jesus Christ and speak of Him. Lord, would You help us to always use our freedom to love, to always use our freedom to help, to always use our freedom to care for others and to point to Jesus Christ. Thank You, Lord, that the ultimate freedom is found in You. Forgiveness of sin, hope, eternal life, all that is found in You. So Lord, we worship You today. Receive our praise, receive our offerings. It is all for You. We pray this together in Jesus' name. Amen.
All things have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. Things that we thought were dead are breathing in life again. You cause Your sun to shine on darkest night. For all that You've done, we will to talk.
Hello, Harvest. I'm really glad that you joined us today, and I'm not just saying that. I am really glad that you actually came back, because last week we went deeper than normal and covered a very difficult passage. And guess what? We're going to be stretched again today as we dig into another section of Jesus and his Olivet Discourse. And I learned a lot in my preparation for these messages, mostly because I had a lot to learn. It kind of reminded me of something that happened a few years ago. I was at a banquet. I was seated next to a very brilliant man, and I knew that he was brilliant because he kept telling me how brilliant he was and how intelligent he was all throughout the meal. Have you ever sat with somebody like that? At one point at our table, the topic turned to grades in school, and I never liked that topic, and he proudly interjected into the conversation that he had never made a B in 4 years of high school. And I just nonchalantly looked back at him and said, well, neither did I. Some of you will get that joke in a few minutes. Suffice it to say that I got a lot of C's, all right? He didn't know how to respond to my statement when I made that. But speaking of brilliant people, many of you in the past week watched the link of Harvest's own Dr. V and his conversation with Dr. Michael Rydelnik. And I have great respect for their intellect and for their biblical knowledge. But I think what I appreciate the most is their humility. And you can find that link online. It takes about an hour to watch. It's at Harvest Bible Chapel, or by just going straight to YouTube and just typing in the words, a deeper dive on the end times. And it's a riveting hour of looking at this passage here in Mark 13 and going much deeper on an end times discussion. Well, this week we are continuing the Olivet Discourse, where Jesus is warning believers about the signs that will accompany the 7 years of tribulation. And he says that there will be destruction, deception, disasters, discrimination, division. And this week, the warnings from Jesus are just going to continue. And we're going to move from earthquakes, famines, arrests, and beatings. And instead, we're going to talk about abominations, desolation, and the Antichrist. And it will go downhill from there with all that's taking place. So, aren't you glad you joined us? You probably are aware of plenty of churches that merely talk about God's grace and His love, and they never preach on the painful passages or the challenges of following Christ or the cost of discipleship. But this isn't one of those churches. And the Bible tells us that our responsibility is to preach the whole counsel of God. And that means the exciting parts and the painful parts, the mountaintop experiences and the low valleys of life. You see, this book contains truth. In fact, it's the written revelation of God. The psalmist affirms to us that all God's words are true. And so there's a reason that he wants to warn us. It's because he wants us to have the full picture, an accurate picture, so that, as we talked about last weekend, we will remain faithful. Well, look in our text, verse 14. We'll begin there, out of Mark chapter 13. But when you see the abomination of desolation standing where he ought not to be, let the reader understand, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Oh, wow. That sounds really confusing. But let's remember the context. The disciples have asked, what will be the signs? Basically, how will we know that it's nearing the end? And Jesus now gives them a phrase that sounds rather strange to us. He says, when you see the abomination of desolation, what? Come back on that, Jesus. That sounds like the title of a scary movie. The Abomination of Desolation, rated R, opens in theaters Friday. Well, in the Old Testament, abomination means anything that was a detestable object. Sometimes it was associated with idolatry. But now, as the disciples hear this, it's starting to ring a bell with them. They knew the Old Testament better than most of us do today. And that phrase, abomination of desolation, was a phrase straight from the book of Daniel, chapter 9. And Daniel mentions the abomination that makes things desolate. Now, this is in a section where the angel Gabriel has come and appeared to Daniel and prophesied about the future and end times. Now, I've divided my sermon today into, are you ready for this? 7 sections. Whoa, probably just scared you with that. We're going to call the first section the prophecy in Daniel. This is the section where we will spend the most time because it's probably the most confusing part of this passage, and yet it's the most important in helping our understanding. Back in Daniel chapter 7 and Daniel 9, it talks about who we commonly refer to as the Antichrist today. And he is called, the Antichrist is called by interchangeable names all throughout the Bible. The term Antichrist means false Messiah, which Jesus warned us about earlier in this passage. Back in the book of Daniel in chapter 9, the Antichrist there is called the Prince Who Is to Come. In Revelation, he's called the Beast. In other places, he's called the Man of Sin or the Man of Lawlessness. And this person, this Antichrist, this abomination, Jesus says, will stand where he ought not to be. Now, Matthew 24, verse 15, gives us a little bit more detail and says exactly where he will stand. This Antichrist will stand in the temple. This will be a man who will be a powerful world leader or dictator, and he will make a covenant with Israel. And according to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 in the New Testament, in that temple he will demand everyone to worship him. Let me read to you from Daniel chapter 9, verse 27b. That's the second part of it. And at the temple, he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him. So according to the book of Daniel, this abomination, this affront to the true worship of God, will occur at the halfway point of the tribulation period. So that would be 3.5 years into a 7-year stretch. And this is different than others saying, "I'm the Messiah." Why it's different is because the exact timing is significant. This will be a bold act from a powerful, charismatic leader who is claiming to be worthy of worship. Dr. V calls this an eschatological defacing of the temple. Let me read our text again for you, and I'll put it up on the screen for you to see it unfold as we're continuing to kind of unpack it. Look at verse 14 again. "But when you see the abomination of desolation standing where he ought not to be," that's the Antichrist, "standing in the temple, let the reader understand." I'm going to stop right there. Why that phrase in parentheses, "let the reader understand"? Is this some editorial note that the gospel writer Mark just threw in the margin? Well, perhaps, except for the fact that Matthew in his gospel says the exact same phrase in Matthew 24. So it's probably not just a little editorial note. You see, evidently Jesus and the Holy Spirit, who inspired the Bible writers, they are begging for our attention to be drawn back to something else that's already been written, that readers of this would be aware of. Jesus is tipping off those who will read this to remember where they've heard that phrase. He's creatively pushing them to go back and look at Daniel chapter 9 to see how this whole puzzle comes together. And through this other passage about prophecy and end times, it will shed some light. And Jesus says, when you see this abomination of desolation standing where he ought not to be, he tells them what they had better do. And we pick it up at the end of verse 14. "Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains." Let me paraphrase what Jesus is saying. You'd better run for your life. Last week we talked about how some try to make this section from Mark 13, verses 5 through 37, somehow tie in with the destruction of Jerusalem that will happen less than 40 years from Jesus' Olivet Discourse. But there was no running to the mountains when Jerusalem was burned and the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. Do you know why? Well, what I didn't tell you last week was the way that Titus destroyed the city of Jerusalem. He laid siege to Jerusalem. He cut off their food supply. The Roman troops surrounded the city and they waited them out for 7 months. And then as people were dying of starvation or had already died, they just moved in and they burned it all to the ground. And an all-knowing Jesus wouldn't have told them to run to the mountains. You know why? That's where the Roman armies were camped out. That would not be the place to run or flee. And trust me, hey, there was no one sprinting to safety. When you haven't had food for weeks, and in some cases months, the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple in 70 AD is something that was prolonged and it was drawn out. But what Jesus is describing is something that will change in an instant. And that leads us to our second stage. We'll call that the suddenness of the suffering. You see, when the Antichrist reveals his identity by demanding worship in the temple, it's going to catch everybody off guard, and it will be sudden. And it will occur right smack dab in the middle of the 7 years of tribulation, and things will immediately go from bad to worse. Look back in your Bible. Let's look at verses 15 through 18. Jesus says, "Let the one who is on the housetop not go down nor enter his house to take anything out. And let the one who is in the field not turn back to take his cloak. And alas, for women who are pregnant and for those who are nursing infants in those days, pray that it may not happen in winter." So Jesus foretells this time in the future when the temple is going to be desecrated by this Antichrist, and it is going to send everyone into panic mode. People aren't going to see this coming. This desecration from this false Messiah is going to be a surprise. It's going to be a shock for them. It will be totally unexpected. And the emphasis is on how quickly the tables are turned. And this is at the halfway point of the 7 years, as I mentioned a couple times before, but it's going to unravel very quickly. And Jesus is saying the split-second decisions will be the difference between life and death for you and for your loved ones. Now we continue reading in verse 19. For in those days there will be such tribulation as has not been from the beginning of the creation that God created until now and never will be. We might call this next section, the third section, the magnitude of the tribulation. These next 3 years are going to be worse than anything since the beginning of time. And so I want to just let that sink in with you for a minute. Worse than anything. That's saying a whole lot. I mean, think of the catastrophes. You could make an impromptu list. Noah and the flood, the 10 biblical plagues in Exodus, the Crusades, the bubonic plague, the Great Depression, the Holocaust, the tsunami in 2004 that killed over 240,000 people from 14 different countries. And yet Jesus says that these things don't scratch the surface compared to the pain that will accompany the time of tribulation. And the complexity of the repercussions will affect the entirety of humanity. Look with me in your Bible at verse 20. And if the Lord had not cut short the days, no human being would be saved. But for the sake of the elect whom he chose, he shortened the days. So we will call this next stage the mercy of God. The mercy of God in his goodness and mercy. He would not allow these intensely painful days to go on for an undetermined time. He only permits this to last for a total of 7 years. There's going to be a definite ending point. And Jesus explains, but for the sake of the elect whom he chose, he shortened the days. We don't know exactly how he did that, but more importantly, who are the elect that he's talking about? We want to say, well, he's probably talking about the Christians or the church. Well, maybe, but we don't technically have Christians yet at this stage, and we don't really have a church until Jesus is ascended to heaven and the day of Pentecost has come. So who do you think he's talking about when he's talking about the elect? I think it's the Jewish people. They were chosen by God, and he will not allow the Jewish people to be destroyed. And so he limits the length of this horrendous stretch that will take place. And furthermore, Jesus draws our minds back to the book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 24, where it talks about your people and your holy city. And that's a direct reference to the Jewish people and to the city of Jerusalem. So even, this is really cool, even 400 plus years before the birth of Christ, when the Jews are in captivity and when Daniel is fervently praying and concerned about God restoring the people of Israel to the land of Israel, even as Daniel is concerned about the present, our God is already looking to the future. He's looking at the big picture, at the total picture. And way back in your New Testament in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, it says, the Lord is not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. That's what his heart beats for. His heart beats for us to repent, to be in a right relationship with him. And the Bible teaches us that the Antichrist is going to betray his promises to the Jewish nation of Israel. And when he breaks his covenant with the Jews in the middle of this painful time, many of the Jews in desperation are going to see the error of their ways, and they're going to start to investigate, and some will embrace God's redemption plan through his son, Jesus Christ. That's awesome. As strange as it seems, persecution and suffering have always attracted people to the one who suffered on our behalf, who became a sin sacrifice for us, even though he was sinless. Well, Jesus continues back in verse 21. We'll pick it up there. And in verse 21, Jesus says, "And then if anyone says to you, 'Look, here is the Christ,' or 'Look, there he is,' do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will arise and perform signs and wonders to lead astray, if possible, the elect." Now, we talked about this last week as just a few verses before, Jesus warned us that false prophets would claim, "I am he." In other words, "I'm the Messiah." But now there's a progression. And now when Jesus is talking about it, Jesus is saying that others who have been deceived will be promoting that false Messiah and accepting it as truth. And Jesus is just blatantly and clearly warning us. And it's recorded for us in the Bible so that during the tribulation period, when deceivers appear and this happens, we will know that it's not true, because we've got the Bible right here to tell us that. We've been warned. And Jesus says false prophets will try to lure away the elect. And there is only one Messiah per universe, and you are not him, and neither is anyone else. Only Jesus, just Jesus. We come to verse 23, and Jesus says in verse 23, "But be on guard. I have told you all things beforehand." We'll call this fifth section, we'll call it the challenge to be diligent. In other words, you've been adequately warned, so be diligent and watch for those deceivers. You know what you're listening for, you know what you're looking for, and you know that's not me. Jesus says, "I've told you all things beforehand." When I say you know that it's not me, that's what a person would have to deduce when they start to think more highly of themselves than they ought. I'm not a Messiah. I am sinful. I'm in need of a Savior. And when we begin to take ourselves off of the throne, what we are choosing to do is to say, "Okay, Lord, you take control, because that's not me. I can't do anything about my sins. Only you can forgive sins." You know, the disciples have spent 3 years being taught and mentored by Jesus. He's wanting them and all future followers to remember what we've learned and been taught, to hold on to the scriptures, to use this as our owner's manual. And that's why at Harvest, we're always encouraging people to be in God's Word and to be in a small group, a community where there can be encouragement and accountability and learning. And now these next verses state what is going to happen to conclude this period of 7 years of tribulation. And it underscores why those small groups and church is so important. Look at verses 24 and 25. "But in those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken." We'll call this stage the response of the universe. These physical and highly visible events are going to be significant. This is going to be cosmic confusion. People are going to be freaking out when this begins to unfold. And we've seen several times in Scripture where God miraculously intervened and he altered the laws of nature to accomplish his purpose. And this global upheaval of the heavenly bodies, these cosmic expressions are going to serve as signs that the God of the universe is leaning forward in his chair. and he's about to get involved in a deeper way. Let me repeat for you what Jesus says is going to happen. The sun will not shine brightly. The moon will give no light. Stars will be dropping from above. Have you got the picture? This is darkness deepening during the night and even during the day. But may I remind you that God does his best work in the dark. God does his best work in the dark. It was on a Judean hillside in the darkness of night when a group of angels lit up the sky as they announced to a group of lowly shepherds, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord." God does his best work in the dark. Now, about 33 years later, on a Friday afternoon from 12 noon on, usually at that time it's the brightest time of the day, but not that afternoon. The sun became dim and it was dark. It was eerily dark. And as God the Father watches his perfect Son hanging there, suspended between heaven and earth, the sun slides into the background and darkness envelops the sky. And see, as the blood rolls down his frame and drips off the tips of his toes and dries in the dust. And remember that with every drop of blood, Jesus Christ is paying for your sins. And he's paying for mine. God really does his best work in the dark. That's why we call it Good Friday, the day when man was at his worst, but God was at his best. And maybe you've experienced that. Maybe it was in the darkest valley of your life when you felt the presence of the Lord like never before. Perhaps it was during a divorce that you didn't want, or a diagnosis that you didn't see coming, or a downsizing at work that you didn't expect, or the death of someone that you loved. And yet in the midst of that low, in the midst of that darkness, you saw God do his best work. And maybe it's because he's the light of the world. Someday at the end of the tribulation period, after 7 years of pain and adversity, 7 years of violence and unrest, at what will be the absolute darkest time in all of civilization, something is going to happen. And when it's gone from bleak to bleaker to bleakest, God will intervene. Look back at your Bible at what will happen as these 7 years of the tribulation come to an end. We pick it up in verse 26. "And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory." We'll call this final chapter the coming of the King. Now, I know a couple of times in this passage, Jesus has said there will be people who falsely claim that they are the Messiah. But let me just tell you, from a logic standpoint and for all practical purposes, you will never have to scratch your head and wonder if someone or something is Jesus. There will be no mistaking him. You won't need to ask Siri. You won't need to ask the person beside you. When you see Jesus, it won't be a guessing game. And in that moment, everything will change. When the sound of a trumpet is instantaneously heard by every person on the planet, when the overwhelming spectacle of the Son of God splitting the sky, riding on a horse, and coming with a sword, rest assured, it's Jesus. It's Jesus. And in that instant, it will be overwhelmingly clear who he is and why he has come. He has come to judge the world. In that instant, the atheists will suddenly believe. Agnostics will become convinced. The lukewarm will be on fire. The hardened hearts will be softened. But it will be too late. Oh, they will believe then. But it will be too late. Because the first time Jesus came to earth, he came in love. But the next time he comes, he will come in power. And he will come to reign as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Are you ready? Are you on guard? Our last verse of our text, verse 27. And then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. Jesus will give the word, and the angels will bring together God's people from everywhere, from all four corners of the world, as God gathers his followers, those he has redeemed and has rescued because of their faith in Jesus Christ. And this discourse itself should motivate each and every Christian to be much more intentional in sharing the gospel with others. For those of you who have put your trust in Jesus Christ, it would be the height of selfishness if you didn't try to bring someone with you to heaven. We talk of the second coming, and yet a fifth of the world has never heard of his first coming. And we must make certain that we are in a saved and growing relationship with Jesus Christ, which can then allow us to positively attract others to consider Christianity. You may have noticed that this sermon falls exactly on the weekend when our nation celebrates our country's independence. And America has been pretty successful for over 240 years. I mean, you can't lie with what's taken place. You can't lie about that. And we believe that we are an invincible country. Well, at least we did before the COVID crisis. And we believe that we are a cohesive country. In fact, we're so proud of it that we even included it in our name, the United States of America. And we believe that we are united. Well, at least we did until about a month ago. But recently it seems that what we thought was the spiritual foundation of America is a foundation with an ample number of cracks, some pretty large cracks, and it's weakening. And our country runs the risk of imploding if we continue to shift our spiritual focus away from Jesus Christ. You know, back when we began this study of the book of Mark, back a number of months ago, in Mark chapter 1, you might recall that there was a conversation that Jesus had with a man. It's found in verse 40, and I'll try to paraphrase it. A man with leprosy came to Jesus, and he begged him on his knees. And he said, "If you are willing, Jesus, you can make me clean." The King James Version says he didn't beg. It just says he fell on his knees and he worshiped Christ. And he said, "If you are willing, you can make me whole." So this leper sets up worship right there, worship time, on his knees before Jesus Christ. Why would he worship Jesus? Well, evidently he realized who Christ was, and he knew that he was deity, that he was God in the flesh. And in that setting, Jesus Christ does two things for this man. The first thing he does is he reaches out and he touches the leper. You say, well, Jesus touched a lot of people. What's the big deal about that? Well, he was a leper. In society back then, if a leper came out of a leper colony and they had to come out in public for some reason, the leper had to shout at the top of their lungs, "Unclean, unclean." Some of them would wear bells around their necks so that people would hear them coming. If you heard a bell ringing and you were out in public, you looked for your young children, you herded your family, and you went to the opposite side so that they didn't come in contact with this contagious disease. It was the COVID of the first century. Probably a little bit more grotesque because leprosy eats away your flesh. And so no one wanted to get close to this leper, but Jesus did. The Son of the living God, before he healed him, he gave him an encouraging touch. Jesus Christ was intentional in everything he did. always. The touch was intentional. The Son of the Living God reaches out and he touches a leper. When was the last time that this man had been touched by anyone? But Jesus doesn't stop there. The second thing he does is he heals the man. He makes him well. His leprosy is instantaneously gone. Do you see what's happening here? The man says, "If you are willing, Lord." He doesn't say, "If you can." He says, "If you are willing." And Jesus is willing. And what the leper received that day was a touch from the Lord Jesus Christ. And it was the first step in the healing process. And I'm here to tell you that what America needs today is a touch from the Lord Jesus Christ. And we need to be a nation that intentionally asks for his touch, begs for his involvement, that worships Christ, that falls on our knees and acknowledges him, that lives by his standards, that realizes that a true Independence Day comes from our freedom in Christ. We don't know how long we each will live or when Christ will return, but we want to have a strong enough faith, a faith that could get us through the tribulations of everyday life, and if need be, that could even get us through the tribulation period. Did you know that over the dome of the Capitol building in Washington, D.C., there is an inscription? It's an inscription that actually talks about Mark 13 and Jesus coming back to earth. It is an inscription which puts this life in perspective. And here's what it says. One God, one law, one element, and one far-off divine event toward which the whole creation moves. And each day we move a step closer to that reality. So let's remember our takeaway from Mark chapter 13. Remain faithful. Remain faithful, because the one who endures to the end will be saved. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you for the hints that you have given us all along the way from the Old Testament and the New Testament, assuring us that you will return, that you will come to take us, that where you are, we may be also. And Lord, may we be prepared and ready for that day. Heaven is a prepared place for prepared people, and we want to be prepared, Lord. So would you help us to lean in more so to your word, to your people, and to your spirit. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. You know, whenever we talk about end times, or we have passages of scripture that talk about the future, especially the tribulation period, I know it can be a little unsettling for some of you and for all of us. And so if you're not really certain, or you have some questions about where you stand spiritually in your relationship with Jesus Christ, we don't want this time to end without you being able to interact with someone. And so what I'm going to invite you to do, if you'd like someone to pray with you, or if you'd like to just talk with someone about maybe questions that you have or next steps in your walk with Christ, you can just text the word follow to 797979. And that's all you need to do. And we'll have someone reach out to you and start that conversation. But please don't let this time go past. If you know that you've never turned your life over to Jesus Christ, this could be your day. And don't let this day end without giving your life to Jesus Christ.
From glory to glory in Jesus' name. From mourning to dancing in Jesus' name. From battle to blessing, we go in Jesus' name. Sing again. From glory to glory in Jesus' name. From morning to dancing in Jesus' name. From battle to blessing, we call in Jesus' name. We see your faithfulness.
In the darkest night, we see your goodness, God. Favor on our lives, everywhere we go. Your grace is on our side. Whoa, your grace is on our side. Whatever comes our way, God be lifted high. Your love will never fail. We will testify that everywhere we go, your grace is on our side.
Hey, I'm so glad we could worship the Lord together today. His word is always on time. It's always living. It's always active. It accomplishes his purpose. So thank you, Lord, for that. Hey, before we go, I want you to know we're here to pray for you. We're here to care for you. And if you just click on the live prayer button, we have staff right now. We'd absolutely love to pray with you, to pray for you before you go today. And I want you to remember this. You are loved.